I would like to officially welcome you to the Open Society Foundations and the Open Society Policy Center. For those who don't know, my name is Nkichi Taifa, and I serve as Advocacy Director for Criminal Justice and as convener of the Justice Roundtable. Founded in 2002, the Roundtable is a coalition of over 100 organizations working in Washington on federal criminal justice policy reform. And in its first decade, the Roundtable was instrumental in the achievement of two major legislative victories that have begun to change the United States' approach to criminal justice, the Second Chance Act of 2008 and the Fair Sentencing Act of 2010. Today's forum, Moving Beyond the Offense, Rethinking Punishment for Violent Crime, and Learning Lessons from Maryland's Unger Cases, is part of the Justice Roundtable's Conversations on Justice, a periodic series which seeks to stimulate dialogue with authors, scholars, artists, distinguished leaders, experts, impacted people, and others who inspire action by sharing information about their justice reform work. I would like at this time to give thanks to the Justice Policy Institute, a national nonprofit organization that changes the conversation around justice reform and advancing policies that promote well-being and justice for all. So the Justice Policy Institute recently came out with a critical seminal report, Defining Violence, Reducing Incarceration by Rethinking America's Approach to Violence. And their assistance in assembling a phenomenal panel who will help us unpack and contextualize why we need to think differently about violent crime, how we can think differently about violent crime, what is the data to support such a new narrative, and the real live human impact. Indeed, if we are to stunt the spiraling growth of the U.S. prison population and tackle rampant racism in our system of punishment, then we must begin to change the narrative on our response to crime. Regardless of whether we're motivated by fiscal or religious or big government or racial concerns, unconsciously lengthy punishments, which essentially throw away the key to the prison door, regardless of how many decades have passed, regardless of age, regardless of infirmity, redemption, et cetera, that should not only offend society's decency, but should be unacceptable to all of our personal consciences as well. Before I introduce our illustrious panel, we're going to begin with a very short clip of remarks by Senator Cory Booker from March 26, 2015, maybe he'll walk through the door too, but to a packed house at a stellar bipartisan summit on criminal justice, which was hosted by Van Jones's Cup 50 organization and Newt Gingrich, and it was held at a hotel in Washington. I happened to be in the audience. I know a number of you probably were in that audience as well that day, and not only heard what you are about to hear Cory Booker say, but I was able to look around that room and see the response of the audience. And it was one of the first times that I heard a public official on his own accord raise the issue of violence and that it's time that the conversation changed. Not only was this distinguished, very, very bipartisan audience receptive, there was loud and sustained applause. And of course, I immediately tweeted about it. So at that time, let's go on and listen to the clip. Look and listen.
Guy come to me when I first became mayor, 15, 20 years earlier, nonviolent drug offense. He couldn't get a taxi license to drive a cab. Then you have on top of that, you can't get food stamps, you can't get public housing. You are told you're not even enough of a citizen where you can't vote. And so what we found in the data analysis of Newark was that when you remove hope from people of reintegrating into society, they often go back to the only thing they can find to pay their rent, which is also nonviolent, goes back to that nonviolent crime of selling drugs in communities. And so we've got to start to understand this obvious thing that we know. I know it was raised in a black church from a Christian perspective, is that redemption is not just good for the soul, but it's good for the society, giving people ways to integrate. Now, I want to go someplace that it's not safe ground yet, because it's not commonly talked about, and this is off script, because the legislation we're pushing is not to scare anybody. Every piece of legislation we have, Randomized Redeemed Act, is all about nonviolent crimes. Mandatory minimums, everything, nonviolent, nonviolent, nonviolent. I just want to go here just to give you a foreshadowing of the future of what we must do as a society. We have labeled so many things violent crimes. It's such a huge wave that we have got to start having an honest conversation about what really we want to be as a society. I interviewed a guy for a job in my office with my team, served 5 years for a violent crime. What did he do? One of his friends, as he was driving around young and stupid, got out of the car with a plastic gun, held somebody up, and stole their money. He ran back to my friend's car, to this guy's car I'm interviewing, and the guy just drove him away and drove away. He had to serve 5 years for that. That's a violent crime. He wouldn't qualify for many of the things and the reforms that are going on in America right now. So I'm just saying this right. We have to re-examine this system as a whole to begin to understand. And I'm going to say this finally, because you've given me the cut. There's an attorney general who has the power to arrest about to come on the stage. He has the power to arrest.
Yes.
So let me just say that this is...
And I'm a lot more worried about him having the power to arrest me than him. I don't want to keep him waiting.
So I just want to say in conclusion, and I know this is going to be said many times at this conference, but I want to say it very personally. King said, change will not roll in on the wheels of inevitability. Just because we're having a conference here and a lot of us getting together, what Newt said, and forgive me for calling you in the first name in front of an audience, but what Newt said is so true. The way Congress moves is at a glacial pace. And right now there is suffering going on in this country. There are people dying. There are children longing for their dads and moms.
Right.
This is not going to change unless we push and fight and work together. Across lines that surprise people, religious lines, political lines, we have to get this done. There is an urgency, a fierce urgency. Thank you.
Well, let's thank Newt Gingrich and Cory Booker for an excellent
Okay, again, thank you, and welcome to our illustrious forum today, moving beyond the offense, rethinking America's approach to violence. And at this time, now that we have seen the phenomenal video from Cory Booker, we're going to move right into introduction of our panel. I want to first introduce Marc Schindler, who is the executive director of the Justice Policy Institute. He's no stranger to the field of justice reform, having served in very high leadership roles at DC's Juvenile Justice Agency, the Department of Youth Rehabilitative Services, as staff attorney for the Youth Law Center, and as a former Baltimore City public defender. He's one of the foremost experts in the field of juvenile justice and justice reform. And we really appreciate the Justice Policy Institute for organizing this panel. We also have on the panel Walter Lomax. He is the executive director of the Maryland Restorative Justice Initiative. Walter Lomax spent nearly 40 years, 40, okay, behind bars for a crime he did not commit, was released in 2006, and has worked tirelessly to address the issue of parole-eligible life sentences and long-term incarceration of parole issues. You know, it's really often said that those who are closest to the problem are closest to the solution, and his work has been the embodiment of that. In 2011, his organization partnered with Justice Policy Institute to produce a documentary and report, Blocking the Exit, to assist with efforts to remove the governor from the Maryland parole process for those serving life sentences. So thank you very much, Walter, for joining us. Okay, we next have on our panel Elizabeth Smith. She is a forensic social work fellow at the University of Maryland School of Law in the Law and Social Services program. Elizabeth has worked with the Maryland Reentry Community and the Unger Advisory Committee project since its beginning in January 2013. Issues involving geriatric reentry are vast, and she works on the necessity of specialized supports and engaging referral networks to try to create a solid base of providers and resources, as well as intensive client case management to begin to change the perception and assumptions about geriatric returning citizens. Thank you, Elizabeth, for joining us today. And we also have Stanley Mitchell. My goodness, these years, 10, 20, 30, nearly 36 years, okay, before his release 4 years ago. He was released with a whopping 30 days of blood pressure medication and a huge sum of $18. 36 years. Since release, he has testified at Senate hearings on Maryland parole issues. He's worked with the ACLU on prison reform issues. He's been active in the prison ministry of his church. He's a radio commentator, most recently featured on Roach Brown's Crossroads show on WPFW in Washington, D.C. He speaks extensively across the country and to youth and people still incarcerated. And he's an entrepreneur, also owning his own transportation business. Welcome, Stanley. So, before I start with the first question, I just want to say that earlier this year in the White House, as part of an armchair discussion that Marshall Project Editor-in-Chief Bill Keller moderated with President Obama and law enforcement officials, the president, in response to Mr. Keller's question, quote, are Americans willing to consider rolling back sentences for people who are violent criminals? President Obama stated in some, he said that it's important to look at the evidence, that there's a diminishing return at a certain point, but we just keep locking up people without, at that point, it being the main driver of violent crime reductions. President Obama said that he would distinguish between those situations and whether or not giving somebody who's 25 years old a 40-year sentence versus a 15-year-old sentence, whether that is the smart thing to do, particularly, he said, because we know that young people do stupid stuff. And as they get older, they get a little less stupid. And Obama said, I speak from experience. And yeah, there was laughter. And he said this, the bottom line. He said that it's smart to start the debate, to start the debate around nonviolent drug offenders. He said, you're right, that's not going to suddenly halve our incarceration rate. But if we get that, if we do that right, then that becomes the foundation upon which the public has confidence in potentially taking a future step and looking at sentencing changes down the road. So Obama said he sees it as a staged process. He said we will lose the public. We will lose the public if we try to do everything at once without having data and evidence. And suddenly we're back into the politics of locking them up. So I say today, thanks to the Justice Policy Institute's report and other work that has been done recently, we now have the data. We now have the evidence. Thanks to the human stories that we'll hear about today, you know, in the Unger cases, we have the data and we have the evidence. Thanks to the great work of all of our panelists, this is the future right now. The future is here. The future is today. So with that, Marc, I want to start off with you, with the start the conversation off with a question. I want you to provide a summary of just what your report, Justice Policy Institute's report, defining violence, what it's all about, how it relates to the Unger case in Maryland. Just start us off, please.
Sure. Thank you, Nkichi. And I want to just say, start off by thanking you for hosting this terrific conversation today, and thank everyone for being here. A special thank you. I don't know where Jasmine is right now, but I know she's running around. Jasmine Mickens doing the logistics, and to my team at JPI who's here as well. You know, I think that it was perfect to start off with Senator Booker's comments and with the way you frame this, because we have to change the narrative and change the conversation that's currently happening in this country. As Senator Booker said, we're not yet at safe ground, but it's up to all of us, I think, to push us in that direction so that this becomes an informed conversation, both by the research and by the individual stories that we have here. And so I'm just thrilled to be here. I'm also really thrilled to be here with this panel, particularly, you know, Walter and Stanley, who I've come to know, and I don't know if Roach Brown is here. Many of you know Roach from WPFW's Crossroads. You know, we were together recently, and here we are again. And between, you know, just these three gentlemen, 100-plus years having served, in prisons in this area for violent offenses. So they all have that in common, but what they all absolutely have in common is people who are contributing to their communities every day and could have been doing that for so much longer, did not have to spend almost 40 years in prison. And so I'm just honored. I think, you know, these people are the true warriors for justice, and we have to be their allies in pushing this information out. And so with our report, with defining violence, what we've tried to do, and JPI, really, this is what we were about, to try to reframe the conversation, to change the narrative. And so really in this report, we started to delve deeply into what are we talking about in terms of the distinction between nonviolent and violent offenses. And what we found, not surprisingly, is it's complicated because in different places in the country, you can be charged with burglary in one place that can be deemed a violent offense, and in other places, nonviolent. So we have to dig into this. As Jason, our research director, has commented, this is complicated stuff, but it's not too complicated for us to delve into this and to make progress on this. So, and we know, as you said, we're here at a time where there's enormous consensus for the first time, a national conversation happening around justice reform, but it's not an honest conversation in the sense that we are just having a conversation from a policy perspective now about nonviolent offenses. And we need to continue to push that conversation, but we need to push it further. We know that almost half the people who are incarcerated in our prisons today are there for violent offenses. So when we talk about significantly reducing the prison population, as we say in the report and others have said, we are not going to do that. We're not going to make a serious dent in the population. We're not going to end mass incarceration unless we start to change laws, policies, and practices around how we treat violent offenders, people who are convicted of violent offenses in our system. So we tried to delve more deeply into that. And we found a couple of things, right? And so I mentioned the difference, for example, in burglary as a statute. Here in D.C., we've made some progress on the assaulting a police officer statute. And I see we have a representative from the D.C. Council. I want to commend our local council for making progress in this area, where that statute was defined very broadly as a violent offense. Literally, wiggling your hands in handcuffs in the District of Columbia could be considered a violent offense under that statute, right? And so, you know, let's dig deeper into what we actually mean when we say violent offenses. Another piece of information that we found as we dug into this is that there are significant number of people who are in prison for enhanced sentences because there was a firearm involved, right? So automatically, in many places, if there's a firearm involved, it is automatically becomes a violent offense with an enhanced sentence. So I think it's nearly 46% of the folks who are in a violent offense enhanced by a firearm. Now, we know, sitting in this room, in this town, that there is essentially zero political will that we've seen to remove guns from our communities. I think what we've seen over the last 30, 40 years is an enormous political will to remove black and brown people from our communities who have firearms, right? But we're doing nothing about the underlying issue, which is that a firearm is involved. So, you know, those are examples as we start to dig into this. The other thing, and as you said, Nkichi, starting to look at what actually the research says about violent behavior, right? So the policy discussion about violent versus nonviolent is driven by just this sort of onerous, it's a violent offense. And if it's gonna be mentioned of a violent offense, then we're not gonna discuss it at all. Though the research says that people convicted of the most violent offenses oftentimes are the least likely to reoffend. So if we're talking about public safety, right, whether that's homicide or sex offenses oftentimes, what the research says is those people are actually quite low risk of reoffending once they return to the community. But we're putting them in for very, very long sentences, as we all know it, at enormous cost, right? And so digging in, and there's more information in the report that you can look at. So what we also show in the report, and thankfully, there are some bright spots and some things that we can look to, I think, to try to push this conversation, right? So in the juvenile justice system, for example, over the last 10 years, we've actually reduced incarceration by over 50%. So there's a big discussion happening in this country, as we should have, about cut 50, right, on the adult criminal justice system. There hasn't been actually that much recognition that we've already cut over 50% in the juvenile justice system, and so there's lessons to be learned from that experience. In addition, a significant portion of those young people who are no longer incarcerated were there for violent offenses, right? So we're not just talking about nonviolent kids in the system who are now in the community, we're talking about violent as well. So there's lessons to be learned there as well. We also know that the Supreme Court has taken note of the research on brain science and adolescent development. I don't know if there's anybody here from the Campaign for Fair Sentencing of Youth. I know the Campaign for Youth Justice is here, really recognizing the changes and what we know about young people. And so we're seeing, you know, serious progress on life without parole, on transfer to the adult system, right? And so we're starting to see the pendulum move in the right direction. We've also seen, in some places for the first time, cutbacks on mandatory minimum sentences, right? So the great work of FAM and others starting to push back on those things. So we can see the tide shifting a little bit, and we point that out in the report. The other thing I'll reference is just here locally. So everybody knows we've had in a number of cities a significant increase, particularly in homicide. And right here where we are, over a 50% increase in the district. The DC Council, and again, we've got somebody here who works for a council member, took, I think, a well-informed and enlightened approach that we need to encourage, right? And so there were proposals on the table for longer sentences, tougher penalties. The council rejected those unanimously and adopted a public health approach to violence prevention here in Washington. And we're seeing that discussion in some other places as well. So we need to build on that. They're modest steps. They're encouraging, but we have to realize, even with all the good work that's being done around the country, the reductions in the prison population have been very, very small, about 1%. And actually, we've seen the jail populations across the country in the last couple of years actually inch up, right? So we've got a long way to go on this, and to get serious about this conversation, we have to deal with this issue of violent behavior. And we know a lot about how to respond to violent behavior, and we have examples of people who are living exhibits of the fact that we don't need to have these draconian policies. So with that, I think I'll stop there. Our report is available on our website. I should have
also... What's that website?
That website is, thank you, www.justicepolicy.org. And I should mention, for those who are tweeting about this and live tweeting, the hashtag is #definingviolence. So I know some of that is happening right now, and feel free to join the conversation, and for those on the phone as well. So I'll stop there, but thank you again, Nkichi, for bringing us together on this.
Thank you so very much. Thank you very much, Marc, for that. And we want to turn right now to Walter Lomax. So Walter, can you reflect just a little bit about just how you view these issues, including the information that is part of the JPI's report?
Thank you, Nish. And I want to start off by saying we have not had this conversation. I was not at the White House meeting. I had no idea what Cory Booker had just said. This is my hand for the first time. So as I share this information with you, I want you to know that I didn't get it firsthand. This comes straight from me. Okay.
From the front lines.
Yes, I mean, so it's, I think it's be safe to say that maybe good minds think alike. When you think about it, our whole system is based on violence. This country was built on violence when war was waged on its Native Americans. The culture breeds violence. This is why we label some people passive-aggressive. They will be passive when necessary, but they will also get aggressive when necessary. No one is immune from it, and it's not predictable. Most of the violence we see committed today are committed by people you would least expect it from. You see it from people raised in wealthy communities, those raised in impoverished communities, from elected officials and police officers every day. You even had the GOP candidate talking about punching someone in the face. I deliberately not going to announce that person's name. Now, violence can occur from careful calculation and emotional reaction or unintended consequences, and by any group. For the last 30 years, the majority of violent crimes are being committed by a younger group of people, and many reasons have been given for this change in behavior: the drug culture, unemployment, disenfranchisement, structural racism, gang affiliations, the list can go on and on. And while we talk about and can separate the different types of violence and who may commit violence, the fact is people do change, and when they do change, they all have basic needs, i.e. housing, employment, access to resources, in order to survive. When we have barriers for their successful reentry, we are not taking into consideration that they have changed. We must thus view the report moving beyond the offense cerebrally, not myopically, but with the understanding that circumstances of the offense will never change, but the individuals who committed them can and do change. Now, in Maryland, there is what is called a parole expectancy built into its criminal justice system, starting at maximum security, progressing to medium security, minimum security, pre-release, work release, family leaves, and parole. And when the system operates correctly, recidivism is lessened for those convicted of violent crimes, even less so. What we found working with the Unger people who have been released under what is called the Unger decision, and all were convicted of violent crimes, is that when they have access to the appropriate resources, housing, employment, health care, and a support system, they will be successful. We were fortunate Baltimore OSI provided the University of Maryland with funding to hire a social worker to work full-time with their reentry, along with social workers and case managers from the Public Defender's Office, who were able to successfully manage their reentry. To date, I believe over 170 cases have been resolved since May of 2013, with not one single return. One can argue that they are older and less likely to commit a crime, and this is true. But what is also true is they all have changed. In fact, in a lot of the cases, that was their first time adult conviction. Now, I would conclude with, if everyone were condemned for the rest of their lives for committing a violent crime, we would cease to exist as a society. Even those of us who may not have committed the act itself, we all have violence in our hearts at some point in time. Personally, I believe anyone who spanks a child after they have been potty trained is committing an act of violence. So I want to thank Marc for this report, Moving Beyond the Offense. We should be rethinking punishment for violent crimes, and we have certainly learned valuable lessons from the Unger releases. This is a conversation we should be having on a much broader scale. Thank you.
Thank you, Walter Lomax, Maryland Restorative Justice Initiative. We want to move next to Elizabeth Smith. Elizabeth from the University of Maryland Law School, can you just tell us briefly just what is this Unger case? What happened under the decision? How did it lead to the release of so many people? And as part of your discussion, if you could please tell us about how many people were actually impacted by the decision, and generally what types of offenses were they convicted of?
Okay, be aware I'm speaking as a social worker. I am not an attorney. I work with many attorneys, so if I misquote something legally, give me a little leeway, please. In 2012, Maryland's highest court in Unger v. State held that the unconstitutional jury instructions certain prisoners were given, they were now entitled to new trials. All had been convicted before 1981. And judges in these cases, in these jury instructions, instructed the jurors that they, the jurors, not the judges, were the ultimate judges of the law as well as of the facts. This is actually something that has been on the Maryland books since the Tory courts. And it was designed to keep England from essentially imposing rule in colonial Maryland. Maryland clung to this until 1981. So the jury instructions given had Unger occurred in the mid-80s, would have had hundreds and hundreds of more, many men and had passed, essentially, before it went into effect. And the court in Unger held the instructions effectively nullified the rule of law and denied, the number is about 232, and I say about because we did just have a gentleman step forward who had been in the hospital in DOC, who actually is another Unger case. So it denied everyone's rights to a fair trial. In 2012, there were at least 232 Maryland prisoners who had been convicted by juries before 1981, when the advisory law instruction was last given, and these folks were still incarcerated, and they were entitled to new trials. We call the 232 the Unger group based on this. So we at the University of Maryland, working with the Baltimore City Office of the Public Defender, began to work on these cases. And between 2013 and 2016, the Maryland courts have ordered approximately 156, and I believe we just had a release last week, and I didn't update this, prisoners released from the Maryland prisons. Almost all have been sentenced to life with a possibility of parole. There are approximately 67 more elderly prisoners who potentially are eligible for court-ordered releases, and many of them will likely be released in the near future. So our recidivism rate, which I think directly relates to what Marc had presented, and we're measuring this by new convictions, excluding traffic and driving offenses, for this 156 is zero. I appreciate the applause, but the applause belongs to the men and one woman, not to me. Because these men and one woman are reflective of an entire population still incarcerated in the state of Maryland. This is not a group that's an anomaly. This is a predictive group. That's all. It's a small sample size. I am not a research professional. If you had sat with me in statistics class, you would know this. But I will tell you there's a need for a much larger, a much wider lens, a larger study. Because what we have seen is men, and I'm going to switch to men, not to diminish the one woman's accomplishments, but it's just a little easier, have overwhelmingly showed us that they are taking active parts, not just re-entering society, but grabbing society and saying, I have contributions, I have interests, I have major things to offer. So, now granted, these men and all were convicted of violent offenses, sex offenses, felony murder, and murder. I regularly have seen cases of the person who was driving the car, the person who was the lookout. They are in prison 30, 35, 40, 45, 50 years when the actual shooter was released on a deal 10 to 15 years in. So I think that that also needs to be considered. The way we construct our laws and at the rate in which we charge people. I was accompanied here to this incredible meeting today by my 14, almost 15-year-old son, who's on his iPad and totally ignoring me, in another room. I've worked cases where people were convicted and sentenced to life at his age. I look at the choices he makes with his friends, and a 15-minute choice, a 15-minute wrong turn. And I look at that child, because that's what he is, despite what he might tell you if you ask him. That child could have been charged and sent to the penitentiary. We don't want to live like this. And I believe heavily in redemption, because that's what prisons were designed to do. It was a stopping point, a chance to gather, a chance to learn skills, and you re-entered society. I am quite a bit older than the average social work student that I work with, and I grew up in a Baltimore that had work release. I was a young married woman in 93 when work release shut down, when parole shut down in Maryland. And I am blessed to be able to work on this project to reopen those doors. And Unger is just one of the doors. There are hundreds of other doors. There are hundreds of other people in the system currently for crimes of this nature who are not only ready to rejoin society, but deserve a place at our table, a part in these discussions. So I am so grateful to be here today, and I'm very, very grateful that this report is on the table to be discussed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth. We're going to now hear from Stanley Mitchell. Stanley, can you share just with us a little bit about your personal story and just how you learned about the Unger decision, just how it impacted you?
First of all, I want to thank everybody for coming out. I want to thank Nikita for giving me the opportunity to put a human face on an Unger person. I'm one of the Unger group. I came out in the first group. I was sentenced to the balance of my natural life plus 18 years plus 5 years running consecutive for a felony murder. It was the state's position that I was in the car when the crime happened. It's my position that I wasn't there at all, but it was the state's position that I was just in the car. The people that the state said did the actual murder never received a day. I had three trials, two hung juries. The third trial, I was found guilty of. For the next 35 years, myself and my family embarked on a battle to win my freedom. I went to court November of 2012 and on a sentence modification because of the amount of time I had served and my age, and I had some health issues that they thought it was time to let me go, but the judge felt different, said that I'll probably reoffend in 90 days because the length of time that I had been incarcerated, and make no mistake about it, I had a criminal history prior to this charge. I was familiar with the Unger decision because I knew Merle Unger, the guy that did originally filed the case. In prison, lifers are a close-knit community, so anything that comes down that might benefit any of us, it spreads like the drum. So I just got another attorney, and another attorney told me that I didn't have to do that, that the public defender office would be handling my case. I was blessed to meet Miss Elizabeth. She came to see me at MCIJ and told me, how would you like to go home in about 6 weeks? And she will tell you that, you know, I took it with sarcasm and I was pretty angry because I've heard that a lot over 35 years that I was incarcerated. I did 35 years, 10 months, 19 days, and 11 hours to be exact. On June the 20th, I walked out of the courtroom. I was in the courtroom all of 2 minutes for the state to say, okay, we made a mistake, we're going to let you go. I refused to report. I said I wasn't going to report to anybody because I hadn't done nothing. They said, fine, you could just go, just give us an address. And they gave me $18 because I was making top salary up $1 a day as a clerk, and I had worked 18 days during the month of June. They gave me $18 and 30 days worth of blood pressure medication and told me to have a good life. And I was blessed that I had God in my life and had strong family support and support of Elizabeth. And Walter here, who's my mentor, who had preceded me to coming out and told me that it's difficult, but it's doable. And that's what I've been trying to do, show that, you know, I'm a human being, and as human beings, you make mistakes, but you can change, and it's not rehabilitation, it's mature. When I was younger, playing in the streets in New York, I was jumping across rooftops playing, thinking none of it. At 68 years old, I think, well, if I jump across the roof, I might get a Charlie horse, might not make it. So you get a little older, you get a little wiser, you make better decisions. And I'm just thankful that I'm here, and I'm thankful that I'm able to put a human face on somebody that is an Unger recipient of the Unger decision. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Stanley. Walter, can you please let us know just how your organization, the Maryland Restorative Justice Initiative, just how your group works with the Unger releasees? I understand that you are Stanley's mentor, you know, how you work with, you know, the people who are coming out, how you work with Elizabeth in the University of Maryland as well.
Okay. In 1993, when we were all removed from the work release and family leave program, when I was moved back into higher security inside the institution, we realized that we need to come together to do something about this change in policy. And so we formed what was called a leadership council. All of the heads of all the self-help organizations inside the institution met. And our plan was to host an all-day seminar where we were going to bring folk from the judicial, the legislative, and the executive branches of Maryland state government in for an all-day seminar. We were going to do workshops the morning half of the day and the second half of the day, once we could assess what each branch of Maryland state government would be receptive to moving forward with this issue. We want to make that a part of the panel discussion. And that was going to be, was going to use what each branch would be receptive to move us forward legislatively. Unfortunately, that did not take place while I was incarcerated, but the Leadership Council still existed. So when I was released in 2006, I met with some of the folk that had been supporting us while I was still incarcerated. And we formed an organization called the Maryland Restorative Justice Initiative. And we began to advocate on the outside for what we had begun to formalize while I was on the inside. Most people talk to me and want to know who are my constituents or who do we represent. We represent those who cannot represent themselves. So our constituents are incarcerated. Those are the folk that we represent. And our efforts is geared toward what their needs are. So our policy is that we bring our issues from the bottom up. We don't deal with what comes from the top down, because we understand that oftentimes there are various agendas. And so we want to make sure that our agenda is in the room all the time. It took us 3 years. 3 years. And why it took us 3 years is because starting out, we just assumed that everyone knew about this issue. But when we went to Annapolis, we soon realized that a lot of these legislators were not even in public office when this policy took effect. And so we realized that we was going to have to be about the business of actually educating them on what this issue is, how it started, who it impacts, and how it would benefit the state if they changed this policy. And so we partnered with the Justice Policy Institute. And in 2011, we produced the first documentary, which was titled Blocking the Exit. We took the documentary, Blocking the Exit, to Annapolis, and we showed it to both the House and Senate Judicial Committee hearing members. And as a result of viewing this documentary, when they heard the legislation, they felt very informed, and we were able to get legislation passed. However, it didn't go far enough. It only gave any sitting governor 180 days to make a decision on recommendation that comes before his office. Shortly after the legislation took effect, however, the sitting governor denied all of the petitions that were before him, up with the 57, which indicated to the legislators that the decision was more political. It did not have or had very little to do with the individuals that had been recommended for parole. Lo and behold, well, his denials took place mid 2012. Shortly after his denials, the Unger decision was decided in 2012. And then in 2013, people began to be released. And mind you, these are the same people that we have been advocating for many, many years. We have been saying that if these folk were to be released back into the community, that they would not be a threat to public safety. In fact, that they will be assets to their neighborhoods and the communities. And as you just heard Ms. Smith talk about how well they're doing since their release. And so the next thing that we done was we produced a report, which is this report here. You can access it on our webpage, mrji.org. In fact, the first documentary that we produced, Blocking the Exit, is up there. This report is up there. And the latest piece, well, this was released in 2015. Unfortunately, we did not get legislation passed at this point. There was a lot of other things that was taking place. I don't want to go into the particulars of that. But following that, we introduced the final documentary, which is titled Unblocking the Exit. And these dealt with folk who were victims, former and current legislators, and people who had been released under the Unger decision. Unfortunately, we did not get legislation passed with that either, but for various reasons. But what's most important at this point is that what we were being told is that these folk haven't been released that long, and so the chances is that they could still recidivate. So there hasn't been enough time. So we began to talk about what the statistics is on folk who do return back to prison. And that's a window, 6 months, year, 18 months, 2 years. Anything after 3 years, the chance is much lesser for folk to go back to prison. Along with that is that everyone that had been released before this policy shifted on parole, that was serving parole eligible life sentences, the recidivism rate for them was less than 6%. And even in that 6%, these folk had not committed another a violent crime. It was either for a technical violation or drug abuse, alcohol abuse, or traffic violation or something of that nature. But not one of them had committed another offense of that nature. The next thing we talked about is the substantial amount of money that has been saved as a result of their release, because each time you have legislation introduced, the first thing that they, well, not the first thing, but one of the things that they ask you for is a fiscal note. How much is this going to cost us? Who's it going to affect? It's not going to cost not one single penny to change this policy. In fact, it would save the state a lot of money, because when we calculated how much money was saved if you use, at that point we were using the 75 folk who had been released, by using $38,000 per individual per year, we had moved up to the savings of $14-15 million. And we were being generous, because some of these individuals had serious medical concerns, and it was actually costing the state upward to $100,000 to keep them incarcerated, as opposed to their release on parole or probation, which costs less than $14,000. Mm-hmm. So that's a substantial amount of money that's being received. And what's most important is that legislators and policymakers use the term that these folk couldn't be released because they would be a threat to public safety, because they had committed this hideous and horrible crime. Yet we see these individuals released back into the community. And I would suffice to say that based on what's happening up there in Baltimore City right now with some of these young people, I would much rather interact with a lot of them than I would just the person that's walking the street. And so that's what Unger, or the folk who've been released under the Unger decision, teaches us, is that people do make mistakes. People do commit crimes. And that's really not predictable, because you see it from all spectrums in our society. But what we do and what we have learned is that people change. Mm-hmm. And when they do change, at the very least, they deserve a meaningful opportunity to return to society. Thank you.
Thank you so very much for that. Thank you. Stanley, I'd like you to follow up on that based on your experience. What are some of the things we should be taking into consideration in determining whether someone can safely return to the community?
Well, there's a lot of things that you consider. I'm not a professional. I'm not a psychiatrist. I only know that my peers that I lived around. First of all, you have to set up some type of therapy for an individual that's coming out. When I came home, I seeked out a therapist for 18 months. I went every Wednesday. At first, I didn't want to, a part of me wanted to go, but part of me didn't. But, because I couldn't see myself talking to somebody that was 25 years old, that had no idea what I had been through or where I had been. But she was good, and she gave me the tools that I needed to adjust. She told me that I had a severe case of post-traumatic stress syndrome, and the soldiers usually have it for 3 years, but I had it for 35 years. She said that I might not be quote unquote the same, but I could adjust, and that's what I've been trying to do based on the skills she gave me. But back to answer your question, I think some type of therapy has to be set up. They have to be some kind of plan in terms of areas that I ran into difficulties with like housing. Housing is major, and you need to have employment. I when I was in prison, prior to them taking the Pell Grants out, I took every college course that they had, and they stopped that. But the problem is that when I came home and I filled out applications, I even got hired on several jobs. And from all my progress reports, I was doing a good job, but then one day they find out who I really was, I was terminated. So I think that you need housing, employment, and employment that people know your history, all right? Because there's no sense in giving somebody a job and they go out and they make bills like car payments and different things that they have to pay, and then 1 week later you say, oh, I found out, you really are this, I don't know who they thought I was. I was the same person that they said you're doing an excellent job. So I think that they're more crucial. And you also need the support of the community. And I come to these things because I want people to stop talking about who we were and who we are today. Because whatever we've done in the past, you can't change it. So you only can deal with the person that they are today. And I think that anybody that does any time incarcerated, I don't care if it's a year, you are different. But if you, when you're talking like individuals that we're talking about, 30, 40 years incarcerated, if you're fortunate enough to make it out of there and be able to put two sentences together, that you can do things that are different. That's what you should talk about, who we are today. That shouldn't be the conversation, not who we were. Because people don't want to help you if they're going to constantly talk about what you did or what you might have done. They have to be concerned about who you are today. So I think a good evaluation process needs to be done prior to releasing anybody. And I think them are the tools that you need to give them once they're released.
Thank you. You're right. Who you are today, that's what's key. Elizabeth, talk to us a little bit about what services your clinic provides to the hunger releasees, and as well as what impact that you might have seen with respect to the people released under returning to their communities.
Okay, I'd like to open that by stating, when we realized that these court cases were moving forward, one of the first people we contacted was Walter Lomax, because we knew we needed a bridge, we knew we needed a checklist, we had to get ready and had to get systems in effect. So my supervisor, Rebecca Bowman Rivas, and I think we may have both emailed you, Walter, me probably more pleadingly, to say, will you come aboard, will you help us? And Walter was instrumental in talking us through what the first few weeks look like. So we were able to form the Unger Advisory Panel from that, and now we started doing most of the pre-release prep. That's now transferred basically to the Office of the Public Defender because they are now handling the legal cases. So we handle post-release case management. And what that covers is very, very broad. We are grateful to be 100% funded by OSI Baltimore. They began funding us in 2013. I basically decided I loved this project as a student. I began working on it prior to my graduation, and I basically stayed until they started paying me. Very good strategy. If you stake out a claim, the University of Maryland eventually gets a grant. So that's what we did. So once we had a social worker, an LGSW on staff there, we began to prepare packets. Everybody walks out of court, and we learn from the first few releases, We make sure you have 30 days of all your medication, not just one. We try and help you guarantee your identification. Identifying documents are a massive roadblock to obtaining anything. You can't get TDAP, temporary disability. You can't get your Social Security if you're entitled to it. You can't get anything without a birth certificate and a Social Security card. And with the timeline on these cases being much shorter than traditional reentry, sometimes 2 weeks notice, there's just not time sometimes to gather those things. So our clinic helps with that. Our clinic gives everybody a hygiene bag with a like protein bar and a thing of water, because when you've been in the bullpen all day and you haven't really slept in 2 days, your meds are off and you haven't eaten a lot of time, so we make sure that if you're indigent and need clothing, we have a bag of clothing ready to go. We have sufficient hygiene so nobody has to be taken to Target an hour after court after hearing how horrible that was. That was something we hadn't thought about. But apparently going from prison to Target is awful. Going to Target for me is awful anyway, but I can't imagine after spending all day in court. So some of this was a learning curve for us too, to figure out how pervasive the needs were. Men were coming out in winter with no coat, no jacket, nothing, just a DOC t-shirt and jeans. So we worked on that. We provide a monthly support group ongoing, again, through the funding of OSI, where we have speakers. Walter helps us coordinate speakers on life skills, speakers of generalized interest. We've had geriatric medical programs come and present. We've done things on budgeting for food and access to local farmers markets and things like that. We do 1 to 2 yearly resource fairs for the gentlemen and their families. The Unger monthly events are also family, so we have breakout sessions where the family can give support to each other. These are not therapy sessions. They are facilitated by a social worker or social work student. And who better to explain what it's like than someone who just went through exactly what you're going through 6 months ago with their fiance, their husband, their brother, their uncle. So we provide all of that. We also, especially for our indigent clients who come out with nothing, they come out with no family. We have one gentleman who outlived his entire family, including his children. You come out with no connections and all of that. We do everything. We've ridden the bus to illustrate how the MTA works. Everyone is given an MTA pass. If they're in an area where they can utilize that, if they go to family outside of Baltimore City, sometimes that's not as useful. Everybody gets a reentry binder. We've developed a geriatric geo-specific set of resources, and it's really evolved over the last 3.5 years to a very much DIY the first month, where you need to go for probation, all the different offices that you might have to visit, Social Security, what the steps are there, birth certificate, MVA. Our group is not released with the court documents, because you often hear folks, you just trade in your DOC ID and you get a Maryland ID. That's not the case for our Unger releasees. They are released directly from the courthouse. If any of you are familiar with Baltimore, they literally walk out onto Lexington Street. They open a big door and everybody is shooed out onto Lexington Street at rush hour. Goodbye. So there isn't a downtime. There isn't a chance to be out processed by DOC. So we provide all of that. We will go to your first medical appointments. I have sat at hospice appointments for some of the gentlemen that have passed. I helped neuter a stray cat that two of our clients got. I did not personally neuter the cat. That's a little beyond social work skills at that point. However, I helped. I got a community organization that did trap and release. These two gentlemen at a transitional home were incredibly attached to this cat. As is the way of some cats, not casting dispersions on cats in general, but she found herself in the family way. So we found homes for the kitten. I found homes for the kittens, and she was neutered, and I kept her in my basement, which almost caused my marriage to collapse, because nothing says I'm really proud of my work like a feral, furious cat in your basement for 3 days. So we don't just do, like, you're not just going to get paperwork filled out with us. My supervisor, Rebecca Bowman-Rivas, really believes case management is therapeutic. We take that super seriously. If our clients have an illness, a death, their spouse loses a job, we want them to call us. When we close gentlemen, even as they move through, and we have managed to move a number of men, they don't need us any longer, they come to events but they don't need us, they can still call us if something arises. We've gotten calls because their wife had a mammogram that indicated that they needed referrals for some cancer treatment. We've had people call us because they're in housing crisis, which does happen in Baltimore City. Housing's incredibly expensive. I know it doesn't compare to here, but in general, it's very, very expensive in Baltimore. And everything that we've been able to do is either through like donation of hygiene products or through OSI Baltimore. And their support's been huge. Now, as far as the impact goes, I'm sitting next to one of my best examples of impact on their community. Mr. Mitchell is doing amazing things and speaking to youth groups and all of that. He is not the only one. And I want to stress that many of our folks have gone on to form 501c3s. They're doing work, particularly with the uprising. A lot of our folks, our returning citizens, were in the streets the next day sweeping with living classrooms to get Pennsylvania North Avenue back underway. They're working with schools in East Baltimore and in West Baltimore. They're involved in their neighborhood groups. They're writing, they're lecturing. We have another gentleman who's just traveled to California with RAP, releasing aging people in prisons to speak. I would say that the impact is enormous because each community changes and adjusts as people come and go. And these men and one woman who has, she is another one who's very involved in her community, have stepped forward and seen gaps and said, why isn't anybody talking to these 12 and 13 and 14 year olds? Why isn't anybody going back in to speak to the youth in Hickey and the other correctional facilities for youth? And they're stepping in. They're not saying, why isn't this happening? They're saying, what can I do to do this? These are men who throughout their time in the DOC saw gaps and filled them, moved forward, pushed for programming, pushed to change things. We do have gentlemen volunteering with the youth organizations, in particular fair sentencing and all of that, because they believe in change and they believe they bring something powerful in their messages and they're willing to tell them. We have people volunteering, we have folks getting married, we have folks stepping in and parenting their grandchildren, grandnieces and nephews. We have people speaking and in their ministries and their spiritual groups. And it's all amazing, but I think they would have been doing this 20 years ago if everything had gone the way it was supposed to. So I think it's important to look at the fact that if these men had served the sentences that they were designed to serve, 25 years maximum, they'd have been productively participating in Baltimore City, and I'm going to talk about Baltimore in particular because I'm a Baltimore native, in our city and the changes that need to happen in our city for the last two decades. What they're doing is spectacular. The only tragedy here is they weren't allowed to do it for the prior two decades. That's the major loss, is that they were deprived of the chance to participate in communities that now need 10 times more help because we blocked an entire generation of men from being part of their communities. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Elizabeth Smith, University of Maryland. I want to remind everyone, if you're on social media, the hashtag is defining justice, #definingjustice. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm so much into justice. Well, when we define violence, we will have justice. Thank you, Mark. Hashtag defining violence. See, I have to have a fast comeback. What I really was thinking about also, I want to invite you to visit justiceroundtable.org if you want background information on all of these issues and any issue related to the criminal and juvenile justice system, justiceroundtable.org. So hashtag defining justice. And Mark, I just... did I do it? at defining violence. Marc, I understand that Maryland passed the Justice Reinvestment Act this year. How many people with similar convictions to what Stanley and Walter carry would be impacted by that law? And tell us just a little bit about that.
Sure. That would be a very small number, essentially zero. So, you know, what we're seeing is these debates around the country where we're trying to push forward on these reforms, and it's limited to folks who are involved in nonviolent behavior as defined by the system. So the example in Maryland is a great example because I think there was very data-informed and good discussion about the types of reforms that we need in Maryland and similar to other states, eliminating mandatory minimums, improving the parole process so people just don't sit and wait, not locking up folks for substance abuse and issues like that. But whenever the conversation got towards somebody potentially being benefited who was in for a violent offense, that's where it stopped, right? And so you had people, you know, and we hear this throughout the country and state legislators, and I think in Congress as well, you know, being very clear, going out of their way to say, this will not benefit anyone being who has been convicted of a violent offense, right? And so while we are seeing, I think, progress, and I think it's a strategic question for, I think, for us as an advocacy community in terms of how we push this forward. I think the president, you know, laid out the dilemma that we have in terms of trying to push forward with a population that may be more sympathetic in the public's view, folks who are convicted of nonviolent offenses, but it doesn't go far enough. And that's one strategy, right, to try to make reforms that we can then study and then have evidence to show that we can do this and then we can push it further. But there's other strategies, right? And so I'm reminded of, you know, for example, the noted and great juvenile justice reformer Jerry Miller, who closed all the youth prisons in Massachusetts in the 70s. And Jerry took the opposite tack. He said, you know, do the reforms with the most serious young people who were there for the most serious behavior. And if we can do it with them, then the argument has already been made that of course we can do it with young people who are there for less serious behavior. So Jerry, you know, took a different tack and said, let's focus our energies and our resources in some ways on in that situation, the young people who need them the most, and show that we can do it even with the toughest kids. And that was a successful strategy then. So we're taking a different tack now, but I think we need to try both of these strategies. You know, and the last thing I'll say, I think what we're hearing today in terms of the story of the Unger cases in Maryland is a, you know, in some ways, and it wasn't a legislative change, right? It was an appellate ruling, right? We need to be clear about that. The courts made this decision, not the legislature. But what we have essentially is really an amazing experiment going on in Maryland with a population of people who were in prison for very, very long periods of time, but they're also now being provided with the types of supports that Elizabeth described to help with that transition, which I absolutely know is a fraction of the cost of what it costs to keep someone locked up. So even all the great work and the great support from Open Society Institute is nothing compared to what it costs to keep those people incarcerated.
Thank you very much. You know, I was just thinking and contemplating about this Freudian slip that I kept making more than once, calling it defining justice instead of defining violence. And I think it was because we're not used to even using the term violence. You know, when we're dealing with change or legislative change or advocacy, we've been running away from it. We've been apprehensive to embrace it because of the backlash that normally comes as a result. So I'm really glad that we are having this conversation to force us to bring this issue out from the corners into the front so that we can be comfortable, okay, with stating the inevitable. Elizabeth mentioned that her son is in the room over there, and sometimes he might have lapses in judgment or whatever. President Obama, in his statement that he was saying, he said he had two teenage daughters, and he said, I'm quoting, although they might be smarter than me, meaning him, that they still have gaps in judgment. I mean, that's what happens. We make mistakes. But sure, people have to pay for those mistakes, no matter how serious they are. for the absolute rest of their lives. And that's what we're really confronted with today. So I really have one last question, really for everyone on the panel or whoever wants to answer on the panel before I open it up for Q&A. And I don't know if your Roach Brown is, will be back in the room for a moment, because I do have one question for him to lead off the discussion. But I want to know, panel, what lessons do you feel that Unger releases have for criminal justice reform with respect to just how we treat violent offenses? You know, just speak something to that. Or what would you say to a legislator? You don't have to answer that, but what other lessons do you think this experiment that Marc has talked about, that the judicial system brought about, not the legislator, what lessons does that have for reform in general?
If I may briefly, because I'm sure that Stanley and Liz would like to comment on that as well. When first, Liz, it was Professor Mike Milliman that leaned on me about this committee. You and Rebecca just reinforced his position, but I'm glad that I got the call, is that what we've learned, and this is very, very, very important, because Marc talked about the fraction of the cause. We met with the full commissioners, parole commissioners, at one point to talk about the work that we were doing, but also about the policy. And they brought up the fact they wanted to know how we were doing and how we were so successful with the transition of the people that's coming out under Unger. They said that if this model could be used, then they wouldn't have to worry about anyone going back to prison. And essentially what that is that it's a complete process from dealing with the social workers and the case managers and actually putting in place what's actually needed for an individual to make a successful transition back into the community. And when you have that as a component and you use that, and to be quite honest, we are only getting these folk with a short period of time upon being released, yet we are still successful. Can you imagine if we had this component in place year, 18 months before they were actually being released back into the community? And so our success has actually come because we put the type of programs in place for them to succeed. And that's really essentially what's needed with anyone that's been impacted by the criminal justice system. And then there's a whole litany of other issues out there that are very challenging. But because we have in place social workers, case managers, support systems, and resources that they have access to, I would say that is the primary reason why we have been successful so far. I mean, one could make the argument again that they're much older, they've spent a lot of time incarcerated, and so naturally they're going to make a change. But let's be quite honest, we know some old people that still act like, I would say DFs and not to use the term damn fools, but we also have some people that you would least expect. So that's maybe one factor, but it is not the only factor. And so if you have these type of resources and these type of programs in place, their chances of success is greatly. Stanley mentioned that we want to be looked at as he is now, not as he was. Because if we continue to indict individuals, you know, let's face it, when we were juveniles, when we were young people, we made some bad decisions, really. But if we were indicted for the rest of our lives for those bad decisions that we made during impulsive moments, then we wouldn't be the people that we are today. But we are the people we are today because we were forgiven for those indiscretions. And that's what we are asking for the folk that are still incarcerated as well as those who've been released. Because looking at me today, if you looked at me when I was 16 years old, you would say that young man is not going to make it. But I'm here. So that has been the result of our success.
Thank you very much. Does anyone else want
to? I just wanted to say really quickly, my coworker Angela and Aloy and I were discussing this, and the idea that you would be forever labeled and defined as your single worst choice, if everybody here just thought of the worst choice up to now they've made, if that's your label and that's your set of obstructions for the rest of your life, who are we as a society? Quite literally, who are we as a human community? Unger's the Unger group is not unique. And I want to capitalize on what Walter and Stanley, they are reflective of a much larger group that desperately needs to be researched, and the data points need to be hard, and it shouldn't be 232, it should be 2,032, 200,032 when you look at the numbers of people that America routinely throws away. So the idea that I might be labeled by a choice I made, heaven forbid, at 15 years of age, would not have led me to be sitting on this panel either today. Thank you.
When you come out of prison, it's like the parable that I always use, is like everybody else is on a Segway and you're crawling. And so when I first came home for 6 months, I was asking people, can I go to the bathroom? And people would look at me and say, yeah, if you got to go, because I was so used to asking people, can I go to the bathroom? I didn't know how to pay the parking meter. Used to just put change in it. Now you got to get a card, go to the end of the walkway, things like that. Everybody takes for granted are extremely difficult and they're scary. Like Ms. Elizabeth said, you know, going into a Target, not going to sleep, you feel like you got the scarlet letter, like everybody's staring at you. So my goal since I've been home is to try to let people know that people make mistakes, that people change, and that it serves no useful purpose to anybody to keep somebody in the cage for 30 years. That's all I have to say.
Okay, President Obama has commuted, I think, 774 sentences to date. There are thousands more who were over-sentenced severely and need their sentences commuted as well. I'm really hoping that people from the White House, people from the Department of Justice Office of Pardon and Attorney, listens and hears your personal story, listens and hears this experiment in real life, real time. It's happening right now from Maryland, from the Unger cases, that people can spend all of this time in prison convicted of violent offenses and come back as very, very strong stalwarts of the community, because you are, in fact, shining examples of that, as Marc said, warriors for justice, shall we say. At this time, we're going to start Q&A, but I want to start it off with Roach Brown, who just came back into the room. And I want to start it off by him, because I think he is another perfect epitome of someone who served time, a long time, on several different occasions, shall we say, convicted of a violent offense, but has come out and has been a very strong member of the community. He is the host of WPFW's Crossroads Talk Radio. He has been very much instrumental in raising issues dealing with the formerly incarcerated. He has some very specific suggestions of his own with respect to what can be done to assist people once they come out. So, Roach, let me give you the mic first before we open up this test.
Thank you. Merry Christmas, everybody.
That's why you say Merry Christmas all the time.
Every day is Christmas. I was sent to prison around Christmas time. I got life around Christmas. I got injured in prison in a guard's ride around Christmas, and I was paralyzed and placed in solitary. I sued the prison for placing me in solitary for 8 months without any justification except we won $300,000 around Christmas. And a month after that, the President of the United States commuted my sentence on Christmas Day.
Which president was that?
Oh, that was Ford. And every day is Christmas, and I'm sorry that my side is hurting because I had to, one of my reindeers kicked me in the side this morning while I was loading up in my cars to make my runs, my rounds. We had the gentleman here, Stanley Mitchell and Walter Lomax and Marc Schindler on our show. One of the things that we've been pushing lately with the Inner Voices of the group I started in Lawton 41 years ago called the Inner Voices. We put on plays inside of prison. We were allowed outside of prison to perform these plays all over D.C., Maryland, Virginia. We took 3 national tours from prison while serving life, taking 15 other guys at 40, 50, 60 years. We went around the country performing prison plays, and we returned from prison, from the street without any incident. And the Inner Voices means that there's something inside of you. If you can touch it, you can get in contact with it, you'll be amazed at what you can accomplish. Thoughts are things. So we taught that with Inner Voices, that no matter what you had, I had life, I was never coming home, I was sent to an insane asylum, I was paralyzed, my mother died, father died, and it didn't make no difference. I knew I was coming home because I believed it and I felt it inside of me. And I got in touch with your inner voice. It's a cleansing process. If you can clean out all the negativity, all the rotten things. Now, I took money from my mother's purse. I took change out of my grandmother's purse. I was going to school and hiding in the closet, coat room, and open up the other kids' lunch bags and take their apples and sandwiches and stuff. Anything that you could do wrong, I did it. If somebody said, don't do it, I'd be the first one to say, shut up, I'm going to do it. And that was the kind of guy that I was. But when I got into prison, the best thing that happened to me was getting life. It woke me up. And by having these gentlemen on our show, we got a project called Offender Anonymous, OA. And it's desperately needed. And we hope we can send it to the White House, send it to the Open Society. We'd like for you, Ms. Smith, and Marc, and everybody to get a part of this. We talked to Cedric Hendricks at Sea Social. OA, it deals with all the issues that Stanley just talked about. I came out and went to the bathroom at the urinal station, and when I got up, the toilet flushed and scared me to death. How did they know I was finished? Who flushed this joker? So I started looking all under the stalls to find out who flushed this toilet. So as I walked through the face bowl to wash my hands, I'm still looking, and the water came up the face bowl by itself. I was afraid. I was scared to death. The toilet's flushing by itself. The face bowl coming on by itself. And I looked at the tissue dispenser, and I was afraid to put my hands over there. I didn't know what that was going to do. So I eased my hand over, and then it come out. I said, oh, my goodness. So I stayed in the bathroom for a solid hour. I was afraid to leave because I didn't know what the front door was going to do. I wasn't ready for what the door had in store for me. So learning how to deal with parking meters, the ATM machines, culturally, many women in prison for 30, 40 years, you can't get a girlfriend. If you do 30 years in prison and you see a young lady and you say, hey, baby, what's your sign? And they laugh at you. Where you been at? My sign. So you ought to step culturally, socially, psychologically. You ought to step technologically. You don't know how to deal with none of this stuff. So we got a program called OA, Offender Anonymous. Everybody that do a long period of incarceration should be a part of OA. It's like AA and NA, Alcoholic Anonymous and Narcotic Anonymous. This fellowship of the Unger situation, we went to Baltimore 2 months ago. I met with the guys at the Unger house, one of the Unger houses. And it was like seeing 12 deer in headlights. They've been locked up 30, 40 years. They didn't know what to do. So we go in the house, sit down and talk to the gentleman and try to share this concept of Offender Anonymous. It should be sponsored by maybe OA, the White House. We've been asking the White House, see social, everybody, to make sure that OA is mandatory for those men and women who do long prison incarceration. Because, again, the servicemen do 2-3 years and then they recognize post-traumatic syndrome. If they recognize that's a problem after 2-3 years, what about 30, 35 years of being out of the society? It's the Rip Van Winkle effect. You sleep for 30 years and wake up, you are lost, people. Please, we need to push something like OA to help men like Stanley or Walter and myself, because I've been out a long time and I still have problems adjusting. So I shut up. Y'all see she's easing up on me. Merry Christmas to you, Nkichi.
Thank you so very much. Rose, you know, Rochelle is actually the architect of a term I think he calls PISS, P-I-S-S, post-incarceration stigma syndrome,
stress syndrome.
Post-incarceration stress syndrome, P-I-S-S. I shouldn't say the whole word, could I? Okay, so this is the time for Q&A. Jeff, raise your hand in the back. She has the mic there. Go to there where she is, or maybe come up here a little bit. So
I'm going to get crowded up there. So if you can just line up next to me, then I'll
okay.
Have a few here
for people to ask. I can start. I have a brief question and then a longer philosophical question.
But we're going to be brief and give your name if you have an organizational
affiliation. Is defining violence available in paper?
If you have a printer.
Oh, okay. It's not.
So we do have summaries. We have summaries on the table, and we'd be happy to send it to you if you contact us.
I'm interested in the term violence from the front end. We've been talking about it, coming out. But how can basically violence, sanctioned and unsanctioned violence, incarceration is nothing more than state-sanctioned violence. So how can restorative justice be used for people who have violent offenses instead of just people are in the juvenile justice system as it currently is predominantly? And have you done any work around that?
Sure. No, I appreciate that. And so just real quick, and I, you know, yes, you can't print the report, but we have it outside, at least summaries, and we'd be happy to send it to folks. So, you know, I think it's a really good question. The, you know, I think Walter was talking about this. We live in a culture of, it's a violent culture, particularly this country, for whatever reason. You know, we have lethal weapons that are, you know, within our communities at unbelievable rates. There is good discussion going on. I mentioned it earlier, and if Darby from Councilmember Grouse's office might want to speak to this as well, because we are seeing in a number of communities and cities starting to push back on this notion of we can only do something sort of at the back end, right? And talking about this issue from a health approach, talking about what are the determinants, what are the things that are causing violence in our communities, and can we interrupt that at the front end, right, and make investments in our communities so that, you know, housing and employment and education and substance abuse and all those things, quite frankly, the things that my kids get in my community, right, that are investments that are made in middle class and upper class, mostly white communities. I mean, we know what to do, right? So there's no question. We have a wealth of knowledge about how to prevent and reduce violence. And we just need to start implementing those. We spend an awful lot of money on things that we know don't work, like incarceration and suppression. And so really, there's a blueprint out there for us if we're willing to follow it. And that's partly about political will.
What about restorative justice
process? Yes, I'm glad you mentioned that. Actually, in the report, we talk about restorative justice, both within the system and beyond, and we reference a program called Common Justice, which is in New York City, which is a terrific program, getting great outcomes, and it's, I think, one of the only restorative justice programs in the country that works specifically with those charged with the most violent offenses as a diversion program. And actually the prosecutor that they had a great partnership with for years just passed in New York City, and is getting a lot of attention, as he should, and maybe that's an opportunity to push this conversation further. Question.
Yes, thank you. Introduce yourself.
Lily Branch Kennedy out of Virginia with Resource Information Help for the Disadvantaged, RIHD. This question is here. I need help. I come here today for help. I didn't even know about Unger, but we're in Virginia. Parole was abolished in 1995. I'm just be real quick with this, but I'm gonna show you the similarities. From 1995 to 2000, we had a jury trial. The jury were not told that parole was abolished until 2000, June of 2000. Inmate Richard Fishback, he sued in the appellate courts. And he won, but on it, he received a new sentence. However, 15 years later, the state of Virginia failed to go and remedy the others who had jury trial. Today we have 400, well, we thought we had 500, but they did a sub, the point is this, we have 421 prisoners who were denied a fair trial. We abolished parole for truth in sentencing. As Congressman Bobby Scott in Virginia said, it's half truth in sentencing. So I come here today, and I think that I was meant to be here. I usually can't get up here because I'm so busy, but I am so glad I came here because it was for me to learn about you and learn about what y'all have done and what y'all have accomplished, because I need that same help. One last thing is, we did two position papers. The bills went in. The bill went into legislation. Here's what our legislators in the Judicial Committee want to do. Instead of fixing their sentence like Fishback, they gave them a new sentence. They want to make them parole eligible. What does parole eligibility have to do with fixing their sentence? So RIHD has been working to correct sentencing errors, injustices that remain corrected from the past that remain corrected today. So if anybody, anyway, and so you know, we are a nonprofit organization, but we're non-funded, and we've been taking on this as volunteers, as mothers and family members who are for fair and equal rights for all persons. So if you can guide us, direct us, any little thing, send us an email or whatever on it, I would appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Lily Branch Kennedy, for all your work. Thank you. Introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Taylor Neville, and I'm with the Who Speaks For Me project, which is my own project that is waiting nonprofit status. And actually, I've been tweeting, and somebody on your justice policy told me to ask the question. First, I want to just note that in D.C., I think Roach Brown and only one other person in this city has received clemency, because D.C. citizens don't have, we're not a state, and they go to federal prison. So that's the first thing I just want to state, that like the model that you all are putting on for the Unger, it's not really an option when you think about clemency and things like that for D.C. citizens. But most importantly, I really want to ask about women. So I can name three women. One who has been home for a couple years, Mary Wilson, 33 years, Washington, D.C. Came home, same thing that Roach is talking about. Shanika Robinson was given over 50 years, case reduced. She's going to be doing 20-some years. There's a woman in this room right now, and I'll let her speak if she wants it, did double digits and had young children when she went in. And so when you talk about men, the problem is that women go to prison too, and more often than not, when they're given these double digits, often the violence is related to domestic violence, but they're usually the primary caregivers. And what's in place? What models are we putting out there? You talk about a hygiene pack, and I'm like, are there tampons in that pack? Are there pads in that pack? Are there painkillers in that pack? What are we really thinking about when we talk about defining violence and thinking about women, who are the fastest growing population of inmates right now? So,
I don't include women because Unger, the women in Maryland were not given this jury instruction, except for one woman who actually had male co-defendants under Unger. I can't speak to the enormity of women's issues in prisons, but I can say in Baltimore we have a program called Marion House, which is amazing. I also believe that women's physiological needs need to be met. I'm active with a number of organizations that do provide menstruation products and diapers and things of that nature to women. Share Baby is an organization that's working to help young families in Baltimore. Unger, unfortunately, has made my lens very narrow because I only had one woman and she went through the Marion House program. Our clinic. These jury instructions, women in Maryland before 1980 were given somewhat different trials, and the jury instructions were somewhat different. Women were treated differently throughout their trials, and the only reason we have included this one woman in the Unger group is she was a co-defendant, so the jury instructions were the exact same as her male co-defendant. To a larger scope of women, I will say the University of Maryland, our clinic, we do have a clinic that does work with some women who have been incarcerated. I don't get an opportunity to work with them because my entire focus is Unger solely, but the University of Maryland does do work with women who were convicted basically as an outcropping of domestic violence, and they committed life preservation, actually, is what they did. They saved themselves and their children most of the time. And in that, I would be happy to take your information and pass it on to my clinical director, Rebecca Bowman-Rivas, if you have questions about that. It's just Unger, the lens of Unger is only this group, 232, which included only one woman. She was supported in coming out through Marion House, which is a great wraparound. They provide case management, they provide housing, they provide family reunification, clothing, assistance finding permanent housing, jobs. They provide all of that. Is it sufficient? I don't believe any of the programs we have in place are enough. And I think, too, when we're looking at long-term sentences, there are women who've done double digits. There are women right now in the Jessup complex who have probably been in since I was born, which is a long time ago. So I think it's important that we look at it as this has to be explored from a data point, because our stories are color illustrations. We need the data, the hard statistical studies have to be funded and have to be done, because it does affect men and women. It affects predominantly, our Unger cases are 90% African American. People in 1970 in Baltimore were 50-50 committing crimes. People that look like me were committing crimes in Baltimore in 1970 and not getting these sentences. So I don't think we can leave race out of it. I don't think we can leave sex out of it. And I definitely don't think we can leave a large-scale study to be done across the nation, looking at the federal and the state systems, because each branch of the DOC is its own little fiefdom. What you're told on the Eastern Shore is not what you're told at Cumberland. The programs at North Branch are not the programs in Jessup. It shouldn't be like that. There needs to be a uniformity. There needs to be major policy changes. And policy, let's face it, is driven by data. That's how our country works. So I would say one of the major steps that we have to take is to do a large-scale study to look at Unger as an example, as a footprint, but not, it's not the whole journey. The journey has acres behind us and miles ahead of us. So I would urge to answer you, yes, women need to be studied and looked at. Those cases need to be brought forward. We need to make provisions, and we need to do so all the way from juveniles to geriatrics. Our incarceration system isn't a reflection of America. It's a reflection of certain portions of America. And we're kidding ourselves if we think it reflects our entire population. And we're doing ourselves and our communities a huge disservice by not giving voice to this.
Thank you very much for the question. Thank you very much for the very substantive response. Before I call on the very last question that we have, I just want to respond to the other part of the question as well. There have been a couple of people that President Obama has granted clemency to in Washington, D.C. Congresswoman Eleanor Holmes Morton, our non-voting representative in Congress from the District of Columbia, has a bill in Congress calling upon the authority of the president to give to the mayor of the District of Columbia to deal with D.C. Cases, because right now it's kind of just shooed in with everything else, and many times D.C. folk are overlooked.
Right. The federal laws don't affect us. Like, if something happens on a federal level, Washington, D.C., people who are incarcerated in the federal prison, but on a local case, we don't get the effect, the benefits of that. And I say we,
yeah, okay. Well, I believe in the we too, because I'm a lifelong resident of the District of Columbia. We need to bring these issues front and square. So thank you very much. And I want to call on our last question. If you can please introduce yourself.
I'm Kara Gotch with the Sentencing Project, and I want to thank everyone for this panel and having this discussion, particularly around life and life without parole and long-term prisoners, because I don't think it gets talked about enough. This question probably is for Mr. Lomax or Roach Brown. You know, my sense is that it seems to me it's prisoners themselves who are lifers, particularly in Maryland, because I have had over the years the opportunity to visit some of the lifers in Maryland, and I'm astounded by the level of organization and thoughtfulness around advocacy opportunities and them trying to organize around change around life sentences, and that's amazing. And I think they, lifers themselves, those who are formerly incarcerated and their loved ones, really are the ones leading this effort to sort of re-examine the wisdom of life sentences. And so I guess my question, and I know Maryland is a great example of that, and Mr. Lomax is one of the reasons why that is. Do you work with other groups, other sort of lifer reform groups around the country, and what is your sense of sort of the level of advocacy and interest among formerly incarcerated people or family members, and what's going on in other states?
Okay, I'm going to ask the last part of your question first. And that is that, yes, we do, a young lady over at the Sensing Project, Nicole Porter, she does organize a conference call with advocates all over the country. And we do, in fact, we have one scheduled for, I believe, the 26th of this month. And that's what we do, share information with what's going on in the various states. So, yes, we do network with them. What we do in Maryland, one of the most important reasons of our success is that while we were on inside, when we formed the Leadership Council, we also created coordinators in every institution in the state of Maryland. And each month, right now it's bi-monthly, we do a newsletter. and we send that information into the institutions with everything that we are doing currently. And we communicate with the coordinators on a regular basis. They keep us informed on what's going on inside of the institution. And by using that as a formula, we are able to organize their family members and friends. And we have a database of about 700 family members and friends and probably a little over 500 prisoners that's in the database. But our organizing strategy is that we organize from the inside and allow the folk on the inside to contact their family members and friends to participate in what we're doing on the outside. Give you an example of what that is that we created a process called the Proxy Vote Initiative. And what that consists of is that we have, one, the individuals on the inside, which was also a part of our legislative initiative as well, to find out what legislative district they were from, who the senator and delegates are in those districts, and then they had their family members and friends who are constituents of those individuals to be in contact with them. And so by organizing like that, we would say is that they would have their family member and friend vote for the candidate that most supports our issue. And so that's our organizing strategy, and that has become an integral part of our success by being able to organize on the inside and allow that to filter back on the outside. What I mentioned earlier is that we tend to formulate our plan of actions and our agenda from the bottom up. And as a result of doing it from the bottom up, we tend to be a lot more successful as opposed to allowing it to be dictated us from the top down.
Okay, thank you so very much. I just want to thank all of our panelists, Marc Schindler, Walter Lomax, Elizabeth Smith, Stanley Mitchell. And I think on behalf of all of you all, I just want to say to President Obama, we have the data. We have the evidence. I want to say to Chairman Grassley and Ryan, we have the data. We have the evidence. Go to www.justicepolicy.org, pull up the report, read it. We have the human stories. We have the Unger cases. No recidivism. No more dangers to society. People age out, most of them, okay, of criminality from juveniles to geriatric. That sounds like the name of a book. All I have to say is that we are beginning now to change the conversation, to change the narrative on this issue. We will never be able to cut the prison population in half, or much larger than that, what it needs to be, until we really tackle some of these very hard issues. So again, thank you very much. Let's give our panelists another big round of applause. Thank you very much.